Hey everybody, it is Mrs. Villamez. I am here to introduce our Unit 2A, which is literary fiction and nonfiction. So we're going to start getting into some stories. Before we get started, I wanted to make sure that we remembered everything that we need to remember about plot from 7th grade, 6th grade, even further back. But I also wanted to introduce some new elements, which is non-linear plot. So let's go ahead and get started so that we can learn a little bit more and get started reading some stories. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is I'm going to hide myself over here. There we go. Let's review some of the linear plot. So linear is just like a line, which means you're going from point A to point B and you're just going in one direction the whole time. So first we have our exposition, and that's when we're introducing the story. So that's when we're getting to know the characters are getting introduced, the setting is being introduced. It's really just the start of the story. Then we have the rising actions, and the rising actions is when you start to understand what the problem or the conflict of the story is going to be. So it's starting to introduce maybe some of the issues that are arising for our characters. The climax is going to be the most interesting part of the story. So that's really when the problem kind of comes to a head. That's when maybe there's like a really big battle scene, or maybe there is a big fight between two people, or maybe they're having to be really brave and do something that they were really afraid of. It's when all the excitement really happens and a decision is being made here. So they're deciding what they're going to do about the problem. Then we have our falling action, which is everything that happens after the climax. And it's kind of when we start to see what are the consequences of that decision that was being made in the climax. So if the person decided to have a big battle scene, who wins, who loses? So we're starting to see what are the consequences of the decision that was made in the climax. And then finally, we have the resolution. That's kind of the end game for our characters in the story. If there's going to be a sequel to the book, they will sometimes leave it on a cliffhanger, as you might have heard it be called. And that just kind of means that there's some open-ended things that you can interpret. Maybe you don't know what happens to those characters. But in general, in a linear plot, there is some type of resolution. So we know exactly what happens to the characters that are still part of the story. So, if you have any questions about some of this, feel free to reach out to your teachers. This is kind of a review of everything that you guys learned in 6th grade and 7th grade, but I wanted to make sure we touch on that before we jump into the new elements, which is nonlinear plot. So, nonlinear plot, I gotta move myself out of the way again. Nonlinear plot is kind of just what it sounds like. So if linear plot is you're going from point A to point B, nonlinear plot, sometimes you'll go about halfway, maybe you'll go back before you make it all the way to the end. So let's talk about some of those elements. So in general, nonlinear plot is a technique sometimes used in literature where events are portrayed out of chronological order. And so we know chronological order means it is happening A, B, C, D, E, F, G. But sometimes stories are told a little bit differently, and they're told that way for different reasons. Sometimes it's a way to kind of insert some drama or make it more entertaining for the reader. So think about some of the stories that you've seen that maybe have like flashbacks or foreshadowing. And if you don't know what those mean, let's go over those really quickly. So flashbacks are interruptions in the story that insert past events that provide background or context to the current events of a narrative. And that's really just a big way of saying that a character is kind of transported, or the audience is kind of transported back in time to something that the character has experienced before. And this kind of helps us understand the character a little bit better as well. Then we have foreshadowing. So foreshadowing is any kind of hint or drama about what is about to happen in the story. Scary movies are masters of foreshadowing. There's always very ominous music and lighting, and they do that because they want the reader to kind of have that build up in their mind. So scary movies will have that, scary books. But it's not always just scary stuff. Sometimes a book will have foreshadowing if there's going to be a major battle or if there's going to be a conflict in the story. And we'll talk a little bit more about that, and we'll see some examples in a minute. So flashbacks and foreshadowing are the two really big ones that you see a lot, but there are things such as subplot and parallel plot as well. Subplot is when there's secondary events and actions in a story that can connect to and or support a main plot. So think about some of the sitcoms that you guys watch, some of the TV shows. You'll have your two main characters, but then sometimes in the story, there'll also be some of the secondary characters having their own little story going on as well. And then at the end of the show, they'll kind of tie back together. That secondary character stuff is really a subplot. So it's the secondary events and actions that connect to or at least support the main plot. So maybe the main story is the most important story, but the subplot kind of adds some interest or maybe some emotion or maybe helps the reader understand what's going on in the main plot better. And then parallel plot is kind of what it sounds like. It's when two main plots are running parallel to one another and they're going to connect or weave in some way. So the official definition is a parallel plot is when the writer weaves two or more dramatic plots that are usually linked by a common character and a similar theme. So it's when you have two equally important stories that are going to have their own linear plot, but sometimes they're going to connect together, whether it's maybe the characters meet together, or maybe it's overlapping. Lapping in time. So let's look at some examples of these plot devices. I'm going to do my best to play these videos for you guys. Okay, so the first one is foreshadowing. So remember, that's the kind where it's kind of giving you a hint as to what's to come. So let's look at this video and see if we can find the foreshadowing.
Well, maybe dinosaurs have more in common with present-day birds than they do with reptiles.
Look at the pubic bone, turned backward, just like a bird. Look at the vertebrae, full of air sacs and hollows, just like a bird.
And even the word raptor means bird of prey.
That doesn't look very scary. More like a 6-foot turkey.
Turkey, huh?
Oh, no.
Okay. Try to imagine yourself in the Cretaceous period. You get your first look at this 6-foot turkey as you enter a clearing. He moves like a bird, lightly bobbing his head. And you keep still because you think that maybe his visual acuity is based on movement, like T-Rex, and he'll lose you if you don't move. But no, not Velociraptor. You stare at him, and he just stares right back. And that's when the attack comes, not from the front, but from the side. From the other two raptors, you didn't even know were there.
And I'm going to pause it there. This is foreshadowing because, for those of you who might not have seen or heard of Jurassic Park, spoiler alert, the dinosaurs that are brought back to life kind of run rampant throughout the park, and it kind of becomes a scary movie later on. So this boy, he feels very safe, he feels very comfortable, and he's just like, eh, velociraptors aren't really scary. And so this doctor kind of points out, like, well, actually, even though they are related to birds, you should probably be pretty afraid of him. And then he describes their hunting habits. And the reason that that's important is because later on, as the audience, we get to see exactly how those velociraptors hunt and how much damage they can do. So we get to see that no, they don't attack from the front, they attack from the sides. And then so you'll get to see that scene later on in the movie. And I'm not going to play it for you here in case that's not your type of thing. But if you have seen Jurassic Park or you're familiar with it, that's a really excellent piece of foreshadowing because it's kind of like this little boy poking fun at what's about to happen. And then Dr. Grant is kind of explaining, like, oh no, just you wait. And that is exactly what happens. So it gives us some context as to what's going to happen later on. So if he hadn't just explained this right here, we might not have understand the importance of how creepy and how scary it is that the velociraptors attack from the side versus the front. And we might be wondering, like, well, what are those things moving around in the grass? But we know because of what happened previously that it's the velociraptor. Alrighty, so let's look at the next type. A flashback. So, a flashback, remember, is when you're, as the audience, you're transported kind of back into a memory of the character. So, in this case, this is from Ratatouille. So, let's watch this video and see this flashback from the character. Such a cute movie. Okay, let me pause it right there for you. Okay, so this flashback is important because it helps us understand so much about this character. So if you haven't seen Ratatouille, this is a food critic who is notoriously tough on restaurants, and the chefs are very afraid of what he's going to say. And then what happens is he takes a bite of this food, and he's instantly having a flashback to his childhood and all the good memories he has with food that was being made for him by his mother. So for him, food isn't just a way to eat, it's a way to connect to his family. And so before, when we thought he was just this big, tough, mean guy, we're getting to see him softened through his flashback, and we start to understand him better as a character. And then our reader, the audience, or in this case, the chefs at the restaurant, can sort of figure out how to handle him moving forward because they have that insight into this character. So this flashback helps the audience understand the character and his motivations throughout the story and gives insight into his development as a character, is what it officially says right here. So let's see about subplot and parallel plot. So subplot. So I tried to pick something that was pretty familiar to everybody. So another Pixar movie, Finding Nemo. So as we all know, the main plot of Finding Nemo is about Marlin trying to find his son who is lost because he gets picked up by a fisherman. And so Dory comes in, and we all know Dory is a very important part of this movie, but she is not part of the main plot, the linear plot of Marlin finding Nemo and having that resolution. However, she is part of the subplot, and her subplot is so important because it helps us develop Marlin's character. She's integral to the plot of Marlin finding Nemo. So let's see a little bit about Dory, and then we'll talk a little bit more.
No, no, you can't. Stop! Please don't go away. Please. No one's ever stuck with me for so long before. And if you leave, I remember things better with you. I do. Look, P. Sherman, 42. I remember it. I do. It's there. I know it is because when I look at you, I can feel it. And I look at you and I'm home.
And so Dory's subplot is more about her trying to find her family, or trying to remember her family and her struggles that she has with memory loss. And so while that's not an integral part, or not a main part of the main story, it's still an important part to her development as a character and to Marlin's development. Because without Dory, Marlin's kind of this like cranky old man, but Dory kind of softens him and helps him look at things in a different way. So without Dory's subplot, the main plot of Finding Nemo might not have folded out in the exact same way. And so again, these plot devices are helping us understand characters better, and they're also directly affecting the plot, the linear plot, in some ways. So again, let's look at the last one, which is parallel plot. So remember, this is the one where there's two plots that are equally as important running side by side, and then sometimes they intersect or overlap. So in this case, this is one of my favorite movies from when I was little. This is Mary-Kate and Ashley Olsen, but they are two characters, and they're not actually sisters in this movie. They just look exactly alike. They're actually complete strangers. And so what happens is one of them kind of grows up in the foster care system, while the other one grows up kind of a spoiled rich girl. And what they end up doing is switching places. So let's look a little bit more into the trailer before I keep talking.
For every man who ever wanted to do right by his daughter.
Daddy! Who is she?
She's gonna be your new mother.
For every woman who ever longed to become a mother.
Drop the bat, let's go!
Just let me smash this ball down too!
Warner Brothers has two perfect answers.
But what I see is me. I see me too.
I'm the woman of the house. And you're off to a year-round boarding school.
Now a couple of identical strangers have decided to play matchmaker.
All they gotta do is meet once, then they'll fall in love for sure. Wow!
Somebody help me!
Now you should look like a real jerk on a horse.
You really should put some iodine on your butt. Cut. Guys like him like girls with food names. Cookie, Muffin, and I'll marry girls like me.
But before they can get them to live happily ever after,
we simply mustn't wait another day.
To what?
To be married!
They'll have to ditch the big bad witch.
Gum in your hair?
Yes. This tastes like a balloon.
It's snail's mess.
Nice.
Warner Brothers Family Entertainment.
Okay, so I'll pause that one there too. So that was It Takes Two. So these two girls have their own plot lines going on. So the girl that grows up in the foster care system is just trying to be adopted by a nice family, and she really likes the lady that's raised her. Her name is Diane. She's who kind of runs the orphanage that she's growing up in. And so her story revolves around trying to become adopted by Diane and getting Diane a husband so that she can be adopted. Because in this story, Diane has to have a husband to be adopted. And then the other story is about this girl who is kind of grown up. It's just her and her dad. Her mom died when she was young. She's kind of spoiled because she's grown up wealthy, but she gets this brand new stepmother. And we all know that kind of story, like this evil stepmother trope. And whether or not that's true, in this story, her whole goal is to get rid of her. And so these two kids happen, they're like, oh, I just wish my life were so different. And what happens is they run into each other, and then they're like, oh, we look exactly alike, we should just switch places and that'll solve all our problems. And then, spoiler alert, it doesn't. It causes a bunch of other new problems, of course. But then their plot actually starts to weave in together, because then they realize, oh, my dad should marry Diane. And so then their plot kind of starts to weave in and out, and then the resolution is both of them together. So you get a resolution of both plots within this movie. So those are some examples of the types of non-linear plots. And remember, these have a huge influence on the linear plot. So obviously a parallel plot is going to be kind of two plots weaving in and out. Subplot is when there's kind of a secondary plot off to the side that develops the main plot. Foreshadowing is when we're getting kind of these hints and these clues about what's to come. And then there is flashbacks, which is the memory. So it's those memory moments that we get that give us insight into the characters and kind of the situation and what's going on. So that is your direct teach portion of the plot. So again, if you have any questions at this point, make sure you're reaching out to your teachers, because we want to make sure that you understand this very well. Let's move on to maybe trying to identify some of these plot devices within literature. So not just through movie clips, but actually through what we're reading, because that's actually when it gets a little bit harder. So I'll help you guys with that in the next video.